So I came to have fun today. Is that okay? Every once in a while, it's just okay to have a little fun, and I'm interested in having a little fun today. To move forward today in our series that we're in, we actually have to go backwards a little bit. So in January and February in our church, we had these 21 days of prayer. It was really a powerful time, and I think a lot of the health that we're experiencing in the life of this church right now is a result of that focused time in prayer. And what we did during that 21 days was we spent a lot of time focusing on the Lord's Prayer in Matthew chapter 6, and just how Jesus taught the disciples how to pray. We methodically went through that prayer together. But even so, there's some important things to revisit when it comes to Matthew chapter 6. And so that's what we're going to be doing today. We're going to do this. We're going to have a little bit of fun. But in the verses that we look at briefly this morning, there's three things that Jesus talks specifically about. He talks about giving, he talks about praying, and he talks about fasting. Giving, praying, and fasting. Those are the three things that Jesus covers. And his premise is there's a right way to do those things, and there's maybe not a great way to do those things. So it's assumed that we do those things. That's probably the first thing that you'll need to understand when we talk about giving and praying and fasting. Jesus is just assuming that if we're following God, that we're doing those things. His point is there's a way to do those things that speaks volumes about where we're at. But we need a little participation today. Before we get there, Jesus is preaching this reclamation message in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, known as the Sermon on the Mount. He's preaching this to this really interesting, diverse crowd. He's reclaiming these truths from God's Word and truths from God Himself that have been distorted and manipulated. And he's reclaiming those things and reappropriating those things to actually bring life to people. And instead of this dead religion, they're actually breathing life into his people. So what I want to do is I just want to set the scene really quick, and then we'll jump into this. So first of all, you are the crowd that Jesus is speaking to in that first century. You're a bunch of Middle Easterners in the first century in a pre-modern world. So what I mean by that is this. It was a man-driven world, it was a male-dominated world, and it was run by power, it was run by kings. Most people found themselves on the outside looking in, back in that culture. That's what we're talking about here. They were using their hands, they were using hard labor to get by, and they were suffering. Most people in that section of the world during Jesus' day were suffering. They lived under tyranny, they lived under essentially dictatorship. Democracy for them, like it just would have been a foreign concept. It would be like you and I living on another planet. It literally wasn't even a dream. They just didn't even know anything that could be like that. It just wasn't a reality for them. Okay, so it was a militarized culture. It was driven by tribalism. It was driven by racism. It was driven by politics, political factions. There was a caste system in place, which meant that those with little got less, and those with more usually got more. That's just the way kind of things laid out. So that's the cultural backdrop. That's the cultural backdrop that Jesus is speaking into as he's addressing this crowd on the side of this hill 2,000 years ago. You're that crowd, okay? Now, that's the cultural stuff. Religiously, it's just as messed up. It's just as messed up. The religious people fell into really two different categories. There were Jews and there were Gentiles. And just FYI, you'll see this in the passage, the Gentiles, they're also known as pagans, okay, which is super pleasant. So you have the Jews and then you have the Gentiles. Now, religiously it was no better, so we're going to get this out of the way. If you've got a green flag, I passed out some flags before the service started. If you've got a green flag, raise that flag and wave it, that green flag. You dirty, dirty Gentiles. Okay, if you have a green flag, you are the pagans. Okay? Yay! All right, if you have a red flag or a yellow flag, if you got a red flag or a yellow flag, wave those. You're the Jews. Okay? You're the Jews in Jesus' audience. So you got the You got the Jews and you've got the Gentiles. Now, put your flags down. If you don't have a flag, raise your hand. Wave at me. Makes me feel good. Okay. You, well, here's, I don't, this might be good news. You don't count. You're the women and children in the day. Okay. And the women and children in Jesus' day, they didn't even count them. Like when Jesus fed the 5,000, it was 5,000 dudes. They didn't even count the women and children when they added that up. So no offense, but you don't count. So we're just going to move right on. Okay. You don't count. So here we go. If you were Jewish, wave your flags. If you're Jewish, the reverence that you have for God would be lost on us today. If you were Jewish in that culture, the reverence that you brought to the table, the reverence by which you would have walked into this room would be lost on us. They practice rituals many, many times over, believing that all of these rituals would appease God and atone for their sin. They made animal sacrifices. They would come immediately prepared to provide for an offering. They chose spotless animals to atone for the lives spotted by sin that they carried around. Their shortcomings. Now, of course, the Jewish leaders took advantage of the sacrificial system of the day, okay, in the shadow of the inner part of the temple. So lock that in. This all happens in the shadow of the temple of God. The temple of God. The place where God dwelt. A place no one else could go into except for the high priest. The one who is qualified to go in. Okay. The religious leaders manipulated the system for personal gain. So, if you're Jewish, hold your flag up. If you have a red flag, put it down. Welcome to town, Pharisees. You who are waving the yellow flag are the religious leaders. You're the religious leaders. When I picked these colors, just so you know, I don't know why I picked, there was a ton of different colors I could have picked. I don't know why I picked stop, go, and go faster. So I don't know why I picked those. But if you're waving a yellow flag, you're one of the religious leaders. All right, everybody point at the religious leaders. Wave your flag. All right, nice. Excellent. In lockstep with culture, those with more got more, and those with less received less. So there was a system in place. So it's in that crowd. You guys are that crowd. So it's in this crowd that Jesus is saying some of these really, if you really pause for a second, they're really harsh words. And it starts with this one. It's in Matthew 6, 1 through 4. So first, giving. So be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you're going to have a reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. Truly I tell you that they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing so that your giving may be done in secret. Then your Father who sees what's done in secret will reward you. So in a nutshell, first off, he's talking to you guys, all the Jews. He's talking to you guys. The second thing I need you to understand is giving to meet needs was assumed. It was just assumed that you were somebody who gave. Okay. The issue was how you did it. That was the big issue. So it was a very shame-based culture. What that meant was one of the worst things that could happen to you is that you were minimized through shame. You fell short. If you were sick, you were shamed. You must have done something for God to punish you. If you were disabled in some way, that must be because your parents were horrible sinners and God is punishing you and taking it. So it's a very shame-based culture. But the flip side of that is you can either be the shamed person or you can be the one casting shame. And one of the ways that you can cast shame is by not only outgiving other people, but by making a pretty big spectacle of how you give. And that's exactly what was going up. They had to keep up this facade of benevolence for all of the others. And so, yes, they would be announced with some big, glorious gift. I've come to present a giant gift at the temple to pay for our beautiful whatever. And here it is, and trumpets and all kind of camels. Who knows what all was going on? But it was always this big procedural announced thing. So imagine you're the person who can't show up with those big gifts. You're shamed, and that system continues to be supported. Now, the religious leaders, where are you? I know you're still getting tired of this. It gets better. The religious leaders, this was not lost on them. They recognized that, boy, if you treated those people that give those big gifts differently, sometimes those gifts would fall on you. And so you tended to treat those people with more differently. In fact, Jesus talks about it at one point. His brother James talks about it at one point. You know, if you see somebody come in and they have all of these jewels on and everything and you give them the seat of honor in your gathering, it's not a good thing. Not a good thing. Well, everybody else gets the cheap seats. There's a lot going on in this passage. So the religious leaders manipulated the system for personal gain. So, here we go. Are you ready? This is where we're at. They were treated differently than those who gave less. Again, super classy. So Jesus says to you, religious leaders, congratulations. Congratulations. You got what you were looking for. You got attention from others. And then Jesus says to you instead, give secretly. Give secretly. Now, we're going to skip ahead. Fasting. We're going to jump over some passages. We're going to get to fasting. Matthew 6, 16 through 18. When you fast, don't look somber as the hypocrites do. They disfigure their faces to show others that they're fasting. Truly, I tell you, they've received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head, wash your face, so it's not going to be obvious to others that you're fasting. Only to your Father, who's unseen. And your Father, who sees what's done, here it is again, in secret, will reward you. Okay, so in a nutshell, again, it's assumed that you are fasting. It's a practice of denying yourself something, food, water, whatever it is, in order to spend that time and that energy, usually praying, and then allowing God to examine your heart, like the psalmist David. Is there any way in me that is offensive to you? If there is, show it to me. I'm going to confess that. I want to give that over. Okay. So again, if you're a religious leader, I know you're, so just switch hands, okay? Okay. If you're a religious leader, this one is actually specifically for you, okay? The days of fasting were Monday through Thursday. Monday through Thursday were the days of fasting. The reason that it was Monday through Thursday had to do with the law of Moses being passed down, some Old Testament stuff, some rules, and all kinds of different stuff, but that's not really the point. If you know that the rules of fasting are Monday through Thursday, and you also know that the market days in Jerusalem are Monday through Thursday, you have a built-in audience. Because there's a whole lot of people coming to town Monday through Thursday during market hours to do their business. And so what these individuals would do, these religious leaders would do, is they would take advantage of this audience, they'd spread ashes on their faces, they'd dress in dirty, tattered clothes, and they would drag themselves through the streets. I imagine moaning and groaning, or, oh, I'm so hungry, but man, I'm just so holy, and just going on and on and on about it. And Jesus' response was, man, that's a really good performance, you hypocrites. That's a word, isn't it? Hypocrites. It's a Greek word. It means actor. Someone doing a performance. Here's a better idea, basically. Jesus says this. How about acting, but this time when you act, why don't you just act like nothing's going on? Act like nothing's going on. Do it without posting about it on the Facebook. Can we do that? I'm about to take a Facebook fast, so I need to post about my Facebook fast on Facebook. I've done that, by the way, just so you know. In other words, don't perform. Fasting in secret is what God honors, not false humility, not false piety. I mean, God's not honoring what you're doing just to be seen and honored by men. He's not going to do those things. Okay. So let me ask you a question. So if you have a red flag, hold it up. If you have a yellow flag, hold it up. How are you feeling right now? Like, why is Jesus picking on us, specifically if you're one of the religious leaders? Why is Jesus picking on us? If you have no flag right now, you're just happy to be here, okay? you're just like, I'm so glad that nobody's picking on me, all right? But I bet every single one of us is wondering the same thing. What about those dirty, dirty Gentiles? What about those pagans? So don't worry, here we go. Ready? Matthew 6, 5 through 8. When you pray, do not be like the hypocrites. Again, there's that performance, that play-acting thing. For they love to pray standing in the synagogues, on the street corners, to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, this is so good, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what's done in secret, there it is again, in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like the pagans, for they think they're going to be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Again, in a nutshell, the people with no flag, wave your hands. If you don't have a flag, wave your hand. He's talking to you right now, actually. He's speaking to you. He's saying, don't be like these other people who are waving their flags. Okay, this whole prayer example is about you not being like them. This is, okay, so he's saying, don't be like the hypocrite religious leaders. Okay, don't be like them. Guilty as charged. You've been praying on the street corners loudly. And again, you've been doing it 3 times a day. You've been doing it at 9. You've been doing it at noon. You've been doing it at 3, which just so happens to coordinate with market hours, Monday through Thursday. So, you know, when an opportunity presents itself, you cannot waste a good audience. You just cannot do it. You got to keep those followers in the loop. They're so interested in what you're doing. Okay. So where are the dirty, dirty Gentile pagans? Wave your flags. Okay. Okay, so listen, you've gone, wave it, proud, do it. You've been unscathed up to this point. Nobody's been talking about you. So here we go. Are you ready? If the religious leaders are acting, you guys win the Oscar. Okay, you guys get the Oscar. For you, it's not enough to be seen. For you, it's not enough to be heard. If this is truly going to work, you have to be experienced. Like, people need to experience you. And so back in the day, the Gentiles, they felt like, in order to gain God's attention, because they were convinced that God was distracted, or their gods were distracted, okay? And so in order to get the attention of your gods, you really had to, light it up, man. Like, you had to get going. You had to say so many things in so many ways. You had to do all these different things to get God's attention or the gods' attention. You had to light it up. You had to dance, yell, smack yourself in the face, throw yourself on the ground, have a fit, do whatever you want to do. You had to do all of those things, whatever it took to get the attention of the gods. Oh, and coincidentally, it got the attention of other people as well. Other people as well. So congratulations, Gentiles. The Oscar goes to you right here, Ed. Ed gets the Oscar. Okay, seriously. I want to reassure you of something today. And you know what? Maybe this is why God has you here today. You do not have to work to get God's attention. You don't have to do anything to get God to pay attention to you. God is not distracted at all. He's focused right now, this very second, specifically on you. He can do that and do that for the billions of other people on the planet because he's God. He is focused on you right this very second, paying enough attention to you that he would do something like give his son. He sees you. He sees you. He knows you. He knows your heart. There is no religious ritual. There is no religious practice that will somehow convince God to bend toward you. He's already done it. He is, that is his automatic posture towards his children. He is bent towards you. You don't earn nearness. You don't earn his attention. He gives it freely, and he is leaning into you right now. That's who he is. That's who he is. And this right here, listen closely, is exactly what Jesus is reclaiming. In these passages, there is a sense in these passages that you need to talk about when you do pray or when you do fast, and there's some lessons to be learned and everything, but ultimately I think we need to get the big picture what Jesus is reclaiming when he talks about these things in that context and when he says these things to us. The idea that God was not distracted would have been foreign to the people that were listening to him that day. It didn't benefit them to think that God was paying attention. Their systems were built on a distant God, a detached God. Inside that temple, a place that not everyone was allowed to enter, was another place. It was called the Holy of Holies. Maybe you've ever heard of that. It's called the Holies of Holies, this inner place inside the temple. Okay, it was a place that was so holy, so sacred, that only the high priest was allowed to make sacrifice in that holy place for the sins of the people. In fact, there was this giant, thick veil, this piece of fabric. It was an inch thick. It took about 300 priests just to manipulate it. It was so big and heavy, but it was designed to be a barrier. It was designed to keep the presence of God apart from the presence of people, the others. It was designed to keep some people out of the presence of God. Okay, so it was this barrier that was in place. When Jesus died on the cross, it says the veil was torn in two. So the access is there now, okay? Just spoiler alert, that's what's going on, okay? But there's this giant veil, 1 inch thick, heavy enough to keep anybody from breaching it, from going where they weren't allowed. The overarching understanding in Jesus' day was that access was for some, but not all. For some, but not all. Those of privilege used religion to their advantage. Yet most people who don't have a flag to wave were on the outside looking in, just hoping that this God that maybe they'd kind of heard about was benevolent enough to care about even them. So Jesus' words, they're harsh, but at the very same time, they're really, really welcoming words. The religious performers have no more access to God than you do. In fact, watch this. All of us, in fact, have access to the Holy of Holies. All you have to do is go to your secret place. Go to your closet to meet with this God who's unseen. Pray. Fast, give, do it all in this secret. You have the Holy of Holies with you. It's no longer some special set apart place just for those who are allowed to have access. Jesus Christ died once for all. For all. The veil was torn in two once for all. Jesus in this section of Matthew 6, completely upends the religious system of the day. He reclaims God's position in relation to us. In relation to us. He's near, not just to some. He's near to all. He's near to all. So can I just give you one takeaway today? There are no flags. There's no flags. The Holy of Holies is with you. Live this life. Live this life for Jesus, knowing that no performance will change that. No performance will change the fact that the Holy of Holies is with you. You are free to give. You are free to pray. You are free to fast with assurance today that the one who loves you is already near you. That's why you do those things. It's why you do those things. There's a section of scripture that we skipped over. It's the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. The Lord's Prayer. We spent quite a bit of time in January and February talking about this. Last fall, I had the privilege at a minister's and mate's retreat of hearing somebody speak specifically about the Lord's Prayer in a way that I had never thought of or ever imagined before. So what I want to do is next week, I want to encourage you to do whatever you got to do to be here. Reverend Dr. Dave Bartley is going to be here. Technically, he's my boss, but he's the district superintendent of the Northwest Indiana District Church of the Nazarene. And I asked him specifically if he would be here with you next week to share with you these insights in regards to what's right smack dab in the middle of all these passages that we just read when he says, this then is how you should pray. This then is how you should pray. That's next week. But can I just encourage you today? I know we've had a little fun and waving the flags and all kinds of different things. And don't give me the flags back. I don't need them. Just take them. Use them. If somebody talks too much, just be like, or this. Or wave this when you're going through a yellow light, which means go faster. Okay. Do whatever you want. But just remember, honestly, I mean, when it comes down to it, there's no flags. There are no flags for you and I to wave, to say, I'm this person, so God, you've got to pay attention to me, or people, you've got to pay attention to me. God has bestowed upon you so much grace and mercy already. Take it. It's yours. Receive it. Yeah. He freely gives it to you. You don't have to earn it. You don't, I mean, it's just a, if you want to know why Jesus got crucified, he was messing with people's stuff. I mean, he literally turned all of this stuff upside down. He ruined their way of life. Thanks, Jesus. But I mean, that's literally what happens. But I tell you what, when you allow God to somehow corrupt the way that we have been thinking how things work, it will mess you up. It will change your heart, and you will begin to have compassion for people who there's no reason you should, because they take, right? They even take from you when you give. But yet somewhere this issue that Jesus has been getting at has been rocking your world and has been uprooting your heart, and you're like, but I want to love them even so. Like, It's the most radical upside-down way of life. But all I can tell you is the more and more you give your life over to Jesus Christ, the more you yield to him, the more you give those things over to him, the more different your life will look than what is normal in this world. And I think this world needs some stuff that's just not normal. This world needs some stuff. It needs some people who are willing to not be conformed to the pattern of this world. Families that are not willing to be conformed to the pattern of this world. Individuals who are not willing to be conformed to the pattern of this world, but instead know how to just do this radical love and this radical generosity and this radical loving of enemies and everything that Jesus is talking about. He is truly reclaiming all of this, these ways that the world and the ways that the church has distorted his truth. And saying, listen, you've heard that it was said, but I tell you, here's life. Here's real life. So I'm going to ask you to stand. Would you read through this benediction with me today? You'll see it on the screen. May the bond of peace of Jesus Christ go with us as we seek to love God as one. May he guide us in humility and gentleness and patience as we love people as we have been loved. May the compassion of Jesus Christ be in us as we serve the world in word and deed. May he bring us together again, rejoicing as his children as we live in real life with Christ. Father, you're so good. You're good to us. Thank you that we can lay our flags down. So there is one banner that we raise, the banner of Jesus Christ. And under that banner, Father, we have complete freedom. We have complete victory. We are free to worship, to pray, to give, to serve, to fast, to love, Father, so freely because of what you've done for us. You've set us free. And so thank you for that freedom that we experience today. And as we leave this place, help us to honor you in everything that we say, everything that we do. It's in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here. Guys, make sure you grab one of those bottles on your way out. Thanks for being here.